Hi, and welcome. So in this session, we'll talk about our experience on Jenkins X in production at Dailymotion. At first, a little bit about me. So my name is Vincent. So you can find me on GitHub, on Twitter. I'm blogging a little on Medium. I've got a few blog posts about Jenkins X, and I plan to write a few more. So if you are interested about what I'll be talking about today, you can find more on Medium. And I'm a developer at Dailymotion. So if you don't know Dailymotion, it's a web video hosting company, so kind of YouTube. So it's started around the same time, but with two main differences. The first one is that we are hosting premium content, so we have less video of cats and more video of news, music, sport. And the second difference is that we are French, so much more cool. How do we make money at Dailymotion? With ads. So we are displaying ads in our videos. So we have our own ad tech platform. So I'm working on that team, and we're currently moving to Kubernetes and Google Cloud. And as part of that migration, we need to rebuild all our tooling to build and deploy our applications. That's why we are interested in CI/CD. And that's where Jenkins X comes. So why did we select Jenkins X for our CI/CD pipelines? So first, we have a few requirements. So as I told you, we want to run on Kubernetes and Google Cloud. All our code is hosted on GitHub, so we need a good GitHub support. And we'd like to switch to the GitHub's way of deploying and managing our applications. So we'd like to have something which is GitHub friendly and will help us adopting GitHub. So Jenkins X meet all these requirements, so that's good for us. Another good point is that we are already using Jenkins internally. So we have a lot of people with Jenkins knowledge, and all our applications already have Jenkins pipelines. So we'd like to reuse that if possible. And the last important point for us was Jenkins X preview environments. So I'll talk a bit more about that later. But it's really something that is interesting for us. So I wanted to talk to name my talk Hello World versus Real World. So with Jenkins X, you have a lot of Hello World. A lot of focus is on the Hello World. Like in a few commands, you can do a lot of things. One command to set up your cluster, install everything, install environment, and do a lot of things. And with just another command, you can import your current project. It will generate as a boilerplate code and define your CI/CD pipeline and deploy your code, your application in staging and production. So it's very nice. It gives us a good first approach to CI/CD. But as soon as you start using it for your own project, that's when you enter the real world and you have a lot of different issues and things you need to do differently. So that's what I want to focus on today in this talk. It's our experience at Dailymotion using Jenkins X in our own real world. So the issue we had and how we fix that. So the first topic I mentioned is the preview environment. So first, a little back on what is a preview environment in Jenkins X. It's a way to deploy your pull request in its own namespace in Kubernetes. So globally, each code for each pull request is going to be deployed individually and in total isolation of every other pull request. So that's good because you can easily see if it deploys first and then run your integration test. So Jenkins X uses Helm to deploy its preview environment. So that's great because Helm is a package manager for Kubernetes and it has it can handle dependencies. So you can, if you are working with microservice architecture, you can deploy your own component with, including all the other one you need for your integration test. So that's great because you can run real integration test in total isolation of the other pull request or whatever happens, and you get great confidence in what you're building before merging it to master. So that's great, and in the Hello world, everything works like just fine. You just define some resources for your pod to make sure that the Kubernetes scheduler will find a good node with enough free resources for all your pods, for your own component and all your dependencies and everything to fit together or in different nodes. And in case if there is not enough resources, you can use a cluster autoscaler. For example, if you are running on a Google Cloud like us, it works very well. It will spin up a new node in your node pool, and it takes like 2 minutes, so it's quite fast, and it will deploy your application node. So that's great, except that in the real world, things get a little different. The first issue we had is that one day a developer came to see me and told me, I've got an issue, my application doesn't want to deploy, I don't know what's happening. I said, oh, don't worry, it's because you will need to wait a few minutes for the cluster autoscaler to do its work and to spin up a new node. I mean, no, I've been waiting for like 20 minutes. Okay, so I did check to see what was happening. And it turns out that we were out of nodes in our node pools. So we put an upper limit to make sure we won't use too much nodes. And it turns out that we had just too many pods. So too many nodes were used. And this is because we had quite a few pods in our preview environments. So basically, you can take all the projects you have. And for each one, you're going to have a few pull requests. So if in our own case, we had like between 5 and 10 open pull requests per project. And you multiply that by the number of dependencies for your own project or component. So for us, it's like 2, 3, 4. And you get the total number of pods you're going to deploy. And that can be a little too much for what you set up for your node pools. So we have two solutions, either set a bigger limit, upper limit for our node pools, or just say, okay, maybe we think a little about that, and maybe we don't need to get all that that pods up and running all the time. So the preview environment are mainly used for automatic tests. As I told you, we use it for our integration tests that are running in our Jenkins build each time someone will push a new commit. And the rest of the time, the environment is there, it's up and running, the application is available if someone wants to go and make a query. But most of the time, nobody uses it, and except for some UI for sometimes time. So basically, we're just using resources for nothing. So what would be cool is to be able to just shut down the pods when they are idle, when they are not used. So there was a great project from the Deis guys, well, which are now from Microsoft, which is called Osiris. So you can check it out. Basically, in a few words, Osiris is a component that you'll need to install in your Kubernetes cluster. And it will automatically inject a sidecar container in your pod, which will act as a transparent reverse proxy. And it will intercept all the incoming requests to your pod and just clone them. So you give him one single configuration, which is a sliding window of time for your idle time, max idle time. For example, if you say 10 minutes and if there are no requests in that 10 minutes, Osiris will just shut down your pod. So in fact, it will find the matching deployment, scale it down to zero, which will shut down your pod. And it will redirect all the incoming traffic to its own component. And when someone will make a request, for example, someone coming to see the great UI you have, it will find the matching deployment again for the request. It will scale it up to one, so it will create one pod, and it will redirect the traffic to the pod. So that depends on your application. For us, for a simple UI, it can take like a few seconds to start up. For a Go API, it's quite fast too. So usually in like less than 1 minute or max 2 minutes, you have your application back and running. So that's great. You just need a few Kubernetes annotations. So there are lots of projects that are configured by Kubernetes annotations. So I'll just show you an example of what it does, how it looks like. So in our preview environment, for one of our applications, this is all the annotations we want to configure. So the first two ones are just to say that we want to use Nginx as an ingress controller. But that part is just what we need to enable Osiris. So we need to put annotations on the deployment and the service, because basically Osiris will hook itself between the service and the deployment. So you need to enable it for both the service and the deployment. And you need to tell it on your service annotation two things. The first thing is the name of the deployment, so that it will know which deployment it needs to scale up and down. And the second thing is that you need to use that annotation, the ingress hostname, to tell Osiris which hostname is used by that service and that deployment. So when there is a new request coming, it will check the hostname, find the matching service, and then find the matching deployment, and then scale it up, and so on. So we use a little trick because it's a preview environment, so it's a dynamic hostname. So we use the ingress controller from the Jenkins X, the Expose controller from the Jenkins X project to automatically inject that annotation for us with a good value. So let's go back to the slide. All right. So that's how we use the preview environments in the real world. So there are a few tweaks that are required. There is a blog post on Medium about how to integrate Osiris in Jenkins X. So you can check it out. There are all the steps defined. So have a look if that's of interest to you. And check out Osiris. It's a very good project. It's still in beta, but for us, it worked very well. No issue. So it's very interesting. Second topic I'd like to talk about today is how we promote to staging and production. So that's a big topic in the CI/CD. So Jenkins X, the way they do it is they use GitOps. So basically, you're going to define all your environment, so staging environment or production environment, in its own Git repository. They do it with using Elm because everything is using Elm in the Jenkins X. So you have you're going to have a single Elm chart that's going to define your staging environment. And in that, each application you want to deploy in your staging environment is going to be a dependency of that chart. So it's going to be a meta chart or an umbrella chart. And you can use the values, the YAML file of that chart to put all the custom configuration you want. So you're going to have only a single one for all your applications. So the global workflow of Jenkins X is that when you make the release of one of your applications, it's going to create two pull requests, one to the staging environment, so to the repository of the staging environment, and one to the Git repository, GitHub repository, that is, of the production environment. So the staging one is configured to have automatic deploy. That means that the pull request will be automatically merged. When it's merged to master, that means the deployment will happen, because the cluster is meant to follow the state of the Git repository. And in production, it's a manual deployment. So that means the pull request will stay open, and it will be just waiting for someone to merge it. And when it will be merged, it will trigger a deployment. So let's have a look at at one example. If we have a look at a pull request made by Jenkins X, that looks like something like that. Your application is going to be upgraded to version 0.0.0.4, and there is going to be just one change. It will be just the version number. So if we have a look at the dependencies, so it's a requirements.yaml file. We can see all the dependencies, all the applications which are going to be installed in that staging environment. So that's how Jenkins X does. I lost my slides. But in our, so that was a hello world. In our real world, we have a different requirements. So the first one is that we'd like to have multiple cluster in production. Because we are operating on a worldwide scale, we want to have one cluster per region, so US, in fact two in US, Europe and Asia. And we have some applications that are going to be deployed in all that other regions and other in only a single region. And also we'd like to have a specific settings per region. And one other big important topic for us is secret management. So we'd like to be able to have a safe way to manage our credentials and not put them in clear text in a Git repository. So the current limitation for us of the Jenkins way, standard Jenkins X way of doing things, is that if we have a single Elm chart per environment, the first one is that we can see all the releases with Elm. So if you do a Elm list, for example, you will see only one release, which will be staging one, for example, in your staging environment. Because every application will be just dependencies, so it will be kind of hidden inside that single release. And to work on that issue, JenkinsX has its own custom resource definition, so CRD, in Kubernetes, which are the release and the applications. So you can see all the applications and in which versions they are deployed in which environment and everything using that to the resources. But because it's using Elm and we are using Elm too, we'd like to make it work with standard Elm tools and be able to use Elm list to see all the applications with the version and everything. Second limitation is that it's very hard to manage conditional dependencies or values when you have multiple cluster or region like we have. So we have to want to have conditional values in our values.html file. That's very difficult when you have a single one. And the last part is about the secret management. So when we started using JenkinsX a few months ago, there was nothing on secret management. So now the JenkinsX team is working on a Vault, HashiCorp Vault integration. I didn't check the tested yet, so I don't know if it's good or not. Just know that it's not finished yet. So we had to run our whole solution. So I'll talk a little bit about that now. So we are using Elm file instead of raw Elm to define our environments. So you can check it out if you don't know that project. Basically, it's a wrapper on top of Elm. So you can use it to define multiple Elm charts. So that's great because it's going to solve one of our issues, which is we'd like to see all the Elm release installed when we do an Elm list. So that's great. And so it supports SQL. So I'm going to show you a little example of how it looks like. So let's find that. So basically, we can list all the releases, and for each release, we can list which chart it is coming from, and the version, and we are using labels to define on which region it needs to be installed. So this one is only on Europe, for example. And we can list one or multiple values.xml file. So we have one value or multiple per application and a specific label to have specific region and all that. So that's great. The second very important thing about Elm file is that it supports secrets. So it has a native integration with an Elm plugin, which is called Elm Secrets, basically, which can handle your secrets directly in your Git repository. It's using SOPS. SOPS is an open source project for Mozilla, from Mozilla. And it will just encrypt your secrets in your YAML or JSON files. So I'm going to show you a little demo. So if you don't know SOPS, I encourage you to test it out. So I'm just going to create a new, to use SOPS to create a new file, so TMP SOPS secrets. Using that, using a KMS key from Google. So it will just create a simple YAML file to start with. So with a key and value, so it supports types. So I can just save it. And that's done. So now, if I just see what's in it, all my values are encrypted. So the value for everything, for different value in an array and everything. Everything is encrypted, so I can safely store that in Git repository. And there is an extra SOPS section, which will list all the key that are used. So we are using a GCP, a KMS key on GCP. So it's listed here. And that's what is going to be used if I want to edit it again. So I'm just going to run SOPS on it. So it will contact Google to get the key. It's going to decrypt that. And I can just do something else, for example, save it, and that's it. It's re-encrypted and saved, and I can do SOPS minus D to decrypt it. And I've got my something else in it. So that's a great way to manage secrets for us. It just works. It's very simple, very basic, and you can control access using your GitHub, your Google settings and credential. So that's good. And the last very important part of mFile is that it supports multiple environments. So we are mapping them to our region or cluster. So that way we can say we're going to install that application in that region or multiple regions. And we can also use custom value files per region. So there are a few impacts with that solution. The first one is that we can't use the JX promote command line. So the basic, in the Jenkins X workflow, you use JX promote in your Jenkins file or in your pipeline. And it will just, so after you tag and release your application, it will just create pull request and every Git repositories. The issue we had with JX promote is that it only knows about M, doesn't know M file. So it knows about how to update the requirements that YAML file, which is all the dependencies and everything, that's right. But when we use mFile, we can't use it. So we need to use something else. JenkinsX has that great project. When I say great, it's really great, I think, which is called UpdateBot. So UpdateBot, its job is just to create and merge pull requests. So if you are working with GitOps, you need to know about UpdateBot. It's a very great tool. Don't look at the README, please, because it's outdated and not complete and everything. Look at the code, try it. The only issue is that it's a Java project. I think it's the only Java project in the JenkinsX ecosystem. But still, it's great. So we use it to... I'll show you a demo first. Sorry. So let's have a little look. So in our Jenkins file, at the end, after the release, I can just call it, and I'm going to say it, okay, I want to push to change our gaps. So UpdateBot knows about a few different ways of updating files in your repositories. So it knows about Docker, about Elm, about JavaScript dependencies, whatever, and regex. So regex is great because you can do whatever you want. You can update one single element of a file in another repository. So I say I want to push to change the regex. That's my regex. That's a new value. So it's my new version from the version file. I can match on a previous line. So if the chart is going to be app name, it's going to find it. And it's going to be updating repositories with nfile.yaml file. So that's the first line, it's going to create the pull request. And the second one, the update loop, is going to watch for the pull request, wait for them to be mergeable. So if there is a Jenkins check, which will report to GitHub, it will wait for it to be ready. And then it will merge it automatically. So I can show you a little demo. Like what it looks like. So that's a pull request created by UpdateBot. So it says, okay, I'm going to update your console app application to 1.15.6. I'm using the regex command, whatever, and it's just going to change that version. So it's working great. As you can see, it's been automatically merged and the branch has been deleted. So that's great. That's fine. So there are still one more impact about using UpdateBot instead of JX promote. It's that by default in Jenkins X, your environments, staging and production, are defined at the cluster level. So that's you have a custom resource definition, CRD in Kubernetes for environment, and you have one for the one element for the staging environment, one for the production one, and that's how they are configured. And that's where you can say, okay, the staging environment is going to be in auto-promote mode. So each time there is a pull request, it's going to be automatically merged and deployed. And the production one is going to be manual deployed. So we can't have that. So actually, Chex Promote is doing. It has its own configuration file, which is updateboat.yaml, which is here. So you can list your GitHub organization, and for each, you can list all your Git repository. So for example, this is our staging environment and production environment. And if you don't want your repository to be auto-updated to for the pull request, you need to say to add that flag, like exit update loop. And it will mean that the update loop won't try to update it to merge the pull request. So here, our staging environment is configured in auto-deploy mode by default, and the production one is configured in manual deploy. So that's going to be configured for each application instead of being configured at the cluster level. So that's one important thing to know. So, in conclusion, if you want to work with Jenkinsx for your CI/CD pipeline, they've spent a lot of time defining a good workflow and best practice, so keep them, really, that's important. But in the real world, maybe you'll need to adapt some part and some tools to fit your real needs. So that's what we did. And if you do that, you may have to contribute. So that's what we did too, because Jenkinsx is a very friendly open source project. So it's contribution friendly. It's very easy to make a new contribution. First, it's written in Go, which is a great language. The code is easy to understand. And people are really helpful on the Slack channel and Kubernetes. So if you have any question, you can go there. There is a great bot that it's called James, and it's very very fast to answer. So whatever question you can ask, the James bot is going to come and answer it like very fast. So real world example here. I had a question one time, so I asked it on the Slack channel, and in less than 2 minutes, I had answers from both of James. So if you don't know them, both of James as a creator of Jenkinsx. So feel free to play with the code and to start to contribute if you want. It's a very contribution friendly open source project, and thanks a lot for that, guys. So just to finish, the main gains for us at Dailymotion with adopting Jenkinsx for our CI/CD pipelines. So first one is GitOps. So we really love it. That's one thing we wanted to do, and it makes everything much simpler. Just take some time from people to learn how to, doesn't need to do everything with Git operation, but it's very powerful. And the shift left paradigm is the second important point for us. So in Jenkinsx, the Helm charts are in the application repository, so they are owned by the developers. So our developers are much more in charge of the everything that happens after they just write their code. So they know about how it's going to be deployed, how it's going to run production. So that's great. And the most important thing for us is a faster feedback loop. So thanks to the preview environments, we have a much faster feedback loop than before, because we have more feedback before we can even merge to master and make a release and start deploying it in staging or production. And last one, of course, is time to market. With an automated CI/CD pipeline, you get a much faster time to market. And of course, that's great for your product. So thanks a lot, and have a good day. Bye.